Thank you. Good evening, everyone.
Buenas noches a todos y todas.
Hello, my name is John Pluker, and I'm here with Antenna Houston and also with my compañera Marianela Acuña.
Mi nombre es John Pluker y yo estoy aquí con Antenna Houston y con mi compañera Marianela Acuña.
And we're here this evening because the Rothko Chapel has made it a commitment to create bilingual spaces for events such as this.
Y estamos aquí esta noche porque Rothko, la Capilla Rothko hizo el compromiso de tener espacios bilingües como este.
And bilingual spaces like this are important because they're spaces in which people can speak whichever language feels most comfortable for them.
Y los espacios bilingües son importantes porque así creamos un espacio donde la gente puede hablar el idioma que quiera hablar y el idioma con el que se siente más cómodo.
And we believe that this is not just a service for people that don't speak the dominant language, but it's actually oriented towards justice and towards the right that people have to speak that language.
Y no es nada más algo para las personas que no hablan el idioma dominante, sino que es algo que está dirigido a la justicia y para que todo el mundo colabore con eso.
And so to that end, I'd like to ask all of you to help us to create that bilingual space. And to do that, you can do a few things. You can keep your headphones close to you so that when the language switches, you can quickly put in your equipment.
Y para eso, entonces, le vamos a pedir a todos y todas que colaboren con hacer esto un espacio de con justicia del lenguaje. Una de las cosas que pueden hacer para eso es que tengan su equipo de interpretación junto a ustedes todo el tiempo.
And also that you don't suffer in silence. So if the equipment is not working, you can just raise your hand and the interpreter who is not interpreting will be happy to help you.
Y también que por favor no sufran en silencio. Si su equipo de interpretación no está funcionando en cualquier momento, simplemente levanten la mano y la persona que no está interpretando en ese momento, cualquiera de los dos, va a venir y los ayudamos.
And your equipment will not be functioning right now because this is the only part that we're doing consecutively. Everything else will be done simultaneously. So if you're wondering why your equipment isn't working, it's because we are here.
Y tu equipo en este momento no está funcionando porque es la única parte del programa de hoy que vamos a estar interpretando consecutivamente así. So si se están preguntando por qué no sirve su equipo ahorita, es porque nosotros estamos aquí.
And finally, if everyone could turn off your cell phones. So not just put it on vibrate, but actually turn it off. And that's to try to reduce the radio waves that are all around in the space.
Y también les vamos a pedir el favor de no nada más bajar el volumen a sus celulares, sino apagarlos para que todas las ondas de sonido no interfieran con el equipo que nosotros estamos utilizando.
Thank you very much.
Muchísimas gracias.
Good evening, everyone. I'd like to welcome you to the Rothko Chapel and to the 2015 Óscar Romero Award. As many of you know who have been here before, and for those who this is your first visit, the chapel is a sacred place that makes visible the interrelated and transformative power of art, spirituality, and human rights. We are dedicated to a more just, peaceful and equitable world, and that part of our practice and commitment to that is first by saying welcome, and all are welcome in this holy and sacred space. This evening, you honor us with your presence, and by being here, you make clear that human rights are non-negotiable, human rights are essential. And this is particularly important in places like Houston, Honduras, and other places all over the world where way too many people live on the margins of society and are not able to live lives full of possibility, as we would believe is intended for all. We thank you very much for what you do for the struggle, la lucha, for human rights. And again, welcome. As part of the evening, the celebration is to lift up a number of people who make tonight possible. And I'd like to start out by welcoming, and you'll hear more about them, but our two honorees, Berta Cáceres and Miriam Miranda. Thank you all for being with us, for traveling so far, and just letting us honor you. Thank you for coming this evening. I'd also like to recognize the Rothko Chapel Board of Directors for the hours they put in, for their sense of stewardship for this place and all they do. And I would ask the board and former board members if you could just stand and be honored. Partially is for we'll have a reception afterwards. You need to, if you have a question, these are the people to ask. So could the board stand and just be honored tonight? And I would be remiss in not also lifting up our guild and volunteers and our staff who every day have that responsibility of making sure that this place is welcoming and inviting to all who come. So I know if staff and their guild members, if you'd stand and let us honor you tonight too. Thank you. As you can tell from your program, there are a number of collaborative partners that helped to make tonight what it is and to make the Óscar Romero Award and the series of programming we've done this fall what it is also. I'm going to name a few people. I probably can't hit everybody this evening, but I'd ask if they'd stand and then we can honor them with one round of applause at the end. The first person is Ana Paula Hernandez, who comes to us from the Global Fund for Human Rights. Ana Paula, great to have you this evening. And you may applaud now. It's always something we try to do. But Karen Engel and the colleagues at the Rappaport Center for Human Rights and Justice at the University of Texas. Where's Karen? Thank you. Also want to recognize Erica De La Garza and the Baker Institute for Public Policy at Rice University. I'm not sure she's here tonight, Anna McNaught, and the colleagues and anyone from neighborhood centers from Baker Ripley, right here on the front row, please stand. We had a wonderful program last night at Baker Ripley where our honorees spoke, and it's one of those moments where you have that really good problem of needing more chairs. So we thank you for the wonderful hospitality. Also, Vita Baird Perez and friends at When and Where I Enter Inc. And I think Vita is here or was here at the reception. Not here this evening, but also a very important part of the programming this fall. Sissy Farenthold, who has been a stalwart here at the chapel, but also a bridge builder between the United States and Central American countries. So Sissy, please stand. And we are particularly honored this evening to have with us Father Esteban Turcios and other friends from the San Antonio Parish in Soyapango, El Salvador, who are here this evening. So welcome. One last person to lift up this evening who sent greetings and couldn't be here is Congresswoman Sheila Jackson Lee from Houston. She really wanted to be here tonight. And one thing I just wanted to say that we talked about this evening, that the Congresswoman has also been very involved with the detention centers, the two detention centers that we have in Texas right now that are operating, that are housing unaccompanied minors and women that have come from Honduras, from other Central American countries. So we wanted to honor her work, and also she brings greetings this evening, so the Congresswoman. It's my pleasure this evening to present to you the Reverend Hannah Atkins, who will deliver tonight's invocation. Reverend Atkins is a rector at Trinity Episcopal Church here at Midtown Houston, a historic church, but one that is still living with such grace and energy and vitality into the future of this city. Reverend Atkins completed a master's level study in theology in El Salvador, as well as serving as director of theological and Christian education in the Diocese of the Episcopal Anglican Church of El Salvador. She was associate priest at St. John the Evangelist in San Salvador, priest in charge at Holy Trinity Church Santa Teresa in San Martin, San Salvador, and also was at St. Andrew's Church in Soyapango, El Salvador. She brings a lot of passion, knowledge, commitment, and experience to the issue that we're here tonight, Reverend Atkins.
Es un gran honor hacer la invocación, dar la invocación para este premio.
It's an honor to be here this evening to give the prayer for this prize, which carries the name of Monsignor Romero, a man who lived and died in the struggle for human rights. And also, he died for being a part of a group of people who is constantly working towards justice and constantly making efforts. And it's wonderful that you've come this evening to honor these two women who continue to fight and to struggle for human rights. There's a book which was published called Team of Corn. The book is called My People Are the Prophet. And this book is in honor of Monsignor Romero, and it describes him in these words. It says, the prophecy of the Monsignor has been accomplished. They were able to get rid of his voice, but not his word. His word has remained in the hearts and the memories of the Salvadoran people. His word continues to be a source of inspiration and hope for many people, Christians and other people, people of goodwill who are fighting for justice for our people and people around the world. His word has transcended the barriers of time and space. It's gotten even into the farthest corners of the world, and his word has not gotten older as time has passed. Remembering Monsignor Romero is remembering his word and also to continue the work. What is the work? The work of liberation. To be a prophetic people, to follow Jesus the way that he followed Jesus, with radicality and with sincerity. Monsignor Romero spoke of the right to organize as a human right. And he said, and he preached in a sermon on April 2nd in 1978 with these words, brothers, the right to organize is a human right. No one can restrict that right. The Constitution gives us certain basic rights, and everything that we do to look for food, everything we do to look for justice, to sow seeds, all of this is good work, but we have to work against insecticides, work against environmental issues, and we have to organize so that we don't die of hunger. All of the people doing this work have rights. And here, the church cannot be silent, because it is a right that people have, and that all individuals have, that we have a right to fight and to claim our rights, and to claim fraternity with other human beings. I'm a Christian pastor. I'm a Christian pastor from Trinity Church. And so I'm speaking from the Christian faith, perspective of Christian faith, but this perspective is one shared by many religions. And I've brought the words of a friend a friend who wrote a really beautiful hymn. A really beautiful hymn that provides a vision of God and a vision of Christ, which is really wide and far-reaching. And though he uses the word Christ, you could also think about it as speaking for other religions or and about the kind of universal rights of human beings. And the hymn is Mesoamerican Christ. Mesoamerican Christ, take your people in your hands to make a new people with dignity and life. Mesoamerican Christ, give us your blood, your lips, to be able to make a people with life. Grifuna Christ, Maya Christ, Indigenous Christ, Lenca Christ, Quiche Christ, Christ of the rivers and the mountains, Christ of the Quetzal, Christ the worker, Christ the maquila worker, Christ the woman working in the factory, Christ the girl on the street, Christ the boy who is shot in a doorway, Christ the student, Christ restless Christ, Christ the grandmother, Christ rotting away in an asylum, Christ sick Christ, Christ suffering from illness, Christ working in the sugarcane harvest, poor Christ, day laborer Christ, Christ who's crossing the borders to go and find work, Christ without papers, Christ dreaming about going home, Christ of a mistreated people, Christ of many, many people fighting, Christ the good news, Christ the voice of the prophets, Romero the truth. Thank you. Amen.
My distinct pleasure and honor to introduce to you this evening Ann Nelson, who will deliver the 2015 Óscar Romero Award keynote address. Following her address, Board Chair Christopher Rothko will present the award to our awardees this evening. Ms. Nelson is an author and award-winning journalist with expertise in the fields of international affairs, media, and human rights. As a former war correspondent, she covered conflicts in El Salvador and Guatemala and won the Livingston Award for Best International Reporting from the Philippines. She is currently a professor at Columbia University School of International and Public Affairs. Nelson is a graduate of Yale University, a 2005 Guggenheim Fellow, and a member of the New York Institute for the Humanities and the Council on Foreign Relations. She is an author, a playwright, and a screenwriter. For The Guys, based on her experiences after the September the 11th attacks, and Savages, a play about the moral issues of military occupation and counterinsurgency warfare. Ms. Nelson, we are grateful for your presence with us and your work, as I said earlier, of taking things that oftentimes are in the dark and need to be put into the light.
It's a very beautiful experience for me to be here, especially in an event that honors Archbishop Romero. I arrived in El Salvador in May of 1980, a few weeks after he had been killed while he was saying Mass. And it was a few days after there had been a demonstration of his followers that was fired upon by the military. And what we heard when we arrived into the capital was that as they fled, they left behind small mountains of shoes in the plaza. They were so desperate to get away. A few months later, I was in the Arzobispado, and I met two women with a friend. I was told that they were Mary Knoll sisters who had just flown back into El Salvador from Nicaragua. A week later, back in New York, I learned that they had been raped and murdered by the military in El Salvador. It was a very, very intense time. And as a 25-year-old reporter, I found that it made me rethink everything that I had ever learned about the world and about life. I met the bravest woman I've ever known at the Arzobispado. Her name was Maria Julia Hernandez. Our daughter, who is now 24, is named Maria Julia, and it is no coincidence. So when I was invited to speak for the Oscar Romero Human Rights Awards and to reflect back on my time in El Salvador and Honduras and the other things that have been going on in the world, it was a very welcome opportunity. So a lot of time has passed since then, and yet these issues, the issues of conflict, the issues of refugees, these are more with us than ever. And we are now confronting a growing refugee crisis once again, starting in the Middle East. So every day, my friends in Washington and those in policy circles say, what can we do? What can we get the Europeans to do? What should be done in the region? And this is really very important. I'm all in favor of refugee relief, but I'm also aware that the refugees who become visible to the international community are only a fraction of the problem. Often they're the people with the money and the resources and the connections to get passage out of the country. And for every refugee that makes it out of their country, there are going to be 10 more people who are stranded back behind, living in the same conditions that drove the others out. So what about these people who are left behind because they're illiterate, because they have no money, because they have family members that they have to look out for and they can't leave? Every refugee crisis creates this challenge and this risk of drawing our attention towards the refugees, but away from the people who are still living in the state of crisis that created it. At the same time, as Americans in this post-war period, not only should we ask ourselves, what can we do? We should also ask ourselves, what have we done in the past that might have contributed to this situation? Sometimes the answer is legitimately nothing. I'm not a person who thinks that the United States is the cause of every problem in the world. But sometimes we do need to take a good hard look at the policies of our countries and the kind of scenarios that they set up and the consequences that play out. I've been studying these conflicts for almost 40 years in many different settings around the world. My work has taken me to Cambodia and Argentina and Romania and China. And I try to draw conclusions, try to make associations to see what is different, what is the same. There are some elements in common. Many of these conflicts are about the struggle for scarce resources. A lot of them are about power grabs that play on pre-existing ethnic tensions. Dictators, nationalists, and economic interests sense an opportunity to forcibly expand their domains. These tensions can build for decades and in a state of malign neglect until they explode into crisis. I'm going to start by mentioning a region that you might not have thought about. It bordered two powerful countries that were different in language, culture, and religion. The local population mixed the two peacefully for generations. They did business. They made friends. They intermarried. They learned each other's language. But there was an invasion that caused people to choose sides, that forced people to choose sides and to choose loyalties, and it created a flood of refugees, and it bred new conflicts in the years to come. Am I talking about the Middle East? Am I talking about Yugoslavia? Well, actually, I'm talking about France. The Alsace-Lorraine, 1870. The Germans and the French people had lived together quite happily for a long time. The Germans invaded, and after they invaded, they obliged the French and the Germans to choose sides by joining the military. And it was one of the most religiously diverse pockets of Europe. It had one of the highest concentrations of Protestants, Jews, and Catholics living peacefully side by side. Once that they were obliged to join the German military, large numbers of Alsatian Protestants and Jews fled to Paris. And they quickly established themselves as professional elite, intellectuals. One family was particularly interesting. It was a Protestant family whose German side was Schlumberger. Now, once they went to Paris, they changed the pronunciation to Schlumberger. And in Paris, they joined a Protestant community that was very special, because the Protestant community in Paris, which was one of the smallest in the Protestant world, also became one of the most dynamic and heroic in the rescue of the Jews of Paris during the Holocaust. Now, as many of you have already figured out, Dominique Dumenil grew up in this community. Her father was one of the Alsatian Protestants that decided to go to Paris. She was the product of a mixed marriage between a German family and a French family. She converted from Protestantism to Catholicism when she married, but she wasn't about sectarianism. She wasn't about ethnicity or religious choices. She was about spirituality and human rights. And I think that it's very special and very important that she came out of that community. And in 1941, her family went from Paris to America, fleeing the Nazis and fleeing once again, but bringing these values of humanity and the living light that is symbolized in this place along with her. That's why it is especially important that she had such an important role in founding the Human Rights Award named after Óscar Romero. As we look at Syria, we now see the largest wave of refugees in the world since the Second World War. It's a regional disaster that's been building for years. The fragile states of Jordan and Lebanon have already been struggling with the influx of Iraqi refugees for years. These fragile states that have barely managed to integrate their own Bedouin communities, find water and housing for their own people, have had to deal with the crisis that's been created by others. And in fact, it has been created in large part through the actions of the United States. There were massive errors of the past that guaranteed this bloodletting. The first was the botched map making in 1919 from the Versailles Treaty, which allowed French and British oil interests to carve up the Middle East with disregard for the people who lived there, their linguistic proclivities, their preferences. The Middle East was carved up along the preference of oil companies and their desired concessions. And it drew maps that almost guaranteed conflicts and tensions in the years to come. The second grave error was the US war in Iraq in 2001, which violated the tenets of the just war. In religious practice, a just war, to the extent that we can accept that such a thing exists, is supposed to be a war of absolute last resort, where every single possible other avenue has been tried and exhausted. Another tenet of the just war is that it leaves things better than when they started. And I'm afraid that we have not succeeded on either count. The United States took a bad situation with Saddam Hussein, and it made it worse for the Iraqis in their loss of security and the destruction of their institutions, for the United States and the price it has paid in lives and fortune, and for the world in spawning ISIS and its affiliates. We tend not to want to think about these things. This is yesterday's story, but people are still living with it every day. Just to look back, we're talking about the deaths of 12,000 Iraqi military and police, 4,400 US servicemen and women, 3,500 contractors, 168,000 civilians in violent deaths, but three times as many civilian deaths in war-related issues, such as the destruction of water facilities and so on. We're talking about a minimum of 500,000 civilian deaths in Iraq. That's not a figure that we hear often enough. In terms of the economic price, Brown University says $4.4 trillion, enough to convert the entire US economy into green energy, for example. Setting in motion interest payments going for another 40 years, which could total $7 trillion. And at the end of all of this investment of blood and lives and property, we have not achieved an improvement for the lives of the Iraqis. And in many ways, to this point, we are lost in the region. The problems continue. We started a war that we didn't know how to finish, and indeed, we didn't know how to conduct. Where did we go so wrong? I think that most of the disastrous decisions, many of them certainly, were made with good intentions by people who thought they were doing a good thing, but they were working out of woeful ignorance. First, our government assumed that this war could be fought like World War II, with unified soldiers lining up in fronts and shooting at each other and winning battles. The modern warfare state is not like that. It hasn't worked that way for a long time. They weren't ready for a fractured society with suicidal operations and the willingness to destroy people and their own property. In the lulls between fighting, there was no underlying democracy to restore. That was an illusion. It was a different society. It had thousands of years of development, and it had its own trajectory. And to take American principles, which are so admirable and so valuable to us, and think you can just impose them by holding an election is naive and dangerous. What has happened in the Middle East under the US instruction is a revolving door of corrupt officials getting rich on US tax dollars before they go into gilded exile. About 10 years ago, I spoke to a friend at the State Department before a round of US supervised elections in Iraq. He was in agony. He said, "We're being pushed to hold these elections. They're going to divide up the power in a way that will exacerbate the ethnic tensions. It's going to blow up." And it did. But he was obliged to push through this vision that was not founded in anthropology, that was not founded in local knowledge, because it was founded on an idea that was not informed, and then he had to watch it happen. In our old post-war model of democratization, we made many assumptions. We thought that if we just removed the dictators, got rid of Noriega, got rid of Somoza, got rid of Saddam Hussein, everything would be fine. Our leaders pushed elections as the first step of reform, not as the culmination of civic education. Those of us in the human rights community thought, with all possible good intentions, that if we brought the military under control and established a free press and electoral process, that progress would follow as day follows night. But now when we look at Central America, we see how flawed that model is. As a young journalist, I covered these conflicts in Honduras, Nicaragua, El Salvador, and Guatemala. These four countries now have elections. They now have free press, and yet it is not all right. They're tormented by violence. The violent death rate in El Salvador and Guatemala is now higher than it was during the war. Now, who's responsible? It's the militarization, but many of the military wear uniforms from private security forces now. It's a private militarization. It's a shifting from the state to the private sector and to the gangs and the Mara Salvatrucha, the drug organizations that have taken the same corrupt practices we saw in the former states and translated into the private sector. And what we have are the suffering people at the bottom who are perhaps worse off than ever. Young people in the cities and towns of Honduras and El Salvador and Nicaragua are being forced and pressed to join these gangs. If they don't, they run the danger of being murdered in their streets and in their homes. Not necessarily by the military that we all had faulted in the past, but by all of these other elements that we don't know how to control. There is a massive flow of refugees northward, but they are less visible in our news media than the Syrians are. Partly because the United States is paying Mexico a large amount of money to capture them on Mexican territory and deport them so they're invisible to us. Over the last year, 68,000 unaccompanied minors from the countries of El Salvador have been deported from Mexico, and an equal number of mothers of young children who are traveling on their own out of this desperation. So what we see now is the number of deportations from the United States dropping, but the number from Mexico increasing 70% over the last 6 months. So Mexico has been paid tens of millions of dollars to execute this policy. I don't say that I have an answer to refugee policies. What I have to say is that this should not be invisible to us. Our policymakers should not be clouding these events. Our public and our citizens should not be ignoring these effects. And as our leaders rightly take Europe to task for its slow response to the refugees from the Middle East, they're skirting the question of our own crisis to the south. What did we as a nation do to contribute to this crisis? Throughout the 80s, what I saw as the wars in Central America raged was that our government poured weapons and military training into a region that was already militarized. It also stepped in and derailed the peace process that was proposed by Mexico and France time after time. It was believed in Washington that the problems of Central America could be solved by military means. And they were wrong. The problems were not solved. They were bounced into the future, and in some ways, they were removed from the instruments of policy. We now see the fruit of that militarization in the next generation. So what can we do to help? Well, first, we need to go humbly back to the drawing board and admit that we don't know what we don't know. We need to rethink our whole approach to democratization and economic development. The European nations have foreign aid budgets that are a certain percentage of their GNPs. Our country's foreign aid budget is a tiny fraction of the Western European nations. But we have so much energy, we have so much know-how, we have so much to offer. If we could take that foreign aid budget and grow it and invest it intelligently, we could make a difference. We could make a real difference. We could harness it to the best minds in our country and to that American energy, and we could form partnerships with people in Central America who have the local knowledge and who have the desire to improve the lives around them. We should celebrate the possibilities of technology. In our lifetimes, we have reduced infant mortality around the world to an extraordinary degree. We've extended lifespans. There's been a green revolution that has grown the food supply. These things are technological miracles, and they've just begun. Now, with digital technology, we could extend that in all kinds of directions. We could extend it to education, universal literacy, which is the building block of civic participation. All of these things are at our hands, and if we invested in the instruments of knowledge, the instruments of progress, we could do so much more than the sorry chapters of our recent past. There are legions of eager graduate students in Texas, in New York, wherever you look, who would love to join this. Finally, we could do more, a lot more, of what the Rothko Chapel is doing here today. Berta Cáceres and Miriam Miranda are the shining examples of real civil society. They represent democracy in action. They give their communities a voice, and they stand up to the forces of official and criminal repression. But their position is fragile. They are constantly in risk of becoming refugees themselves. They know that the moment they are driven out of their country, their effectiveness is compromised. And as the former director of the Committee to Protect Journalists, I saw many, many people who were very committed to change in their countries, who did everything they could within the context of their countries. They were finally driven out. They came to the United States. They were safe, but they could no longer do their life's work. So to look at everything we can do to support the work of Berta and Miriam is extremely important. Every day of work they complete for their communities and their homes is a triumph. The Óscar Romero Award will help them, and it will help the people that they help. I don't know how many of you have been to Honduras. Honduras means the depths. And when you fly into Tegucigalpa, the plane comes in and takes a steep dive to go over a mountain, hit the runway, moves along, and screeches to a halt to avoid running into another mountain. It's a very exciting experience. I remember in the 80s going to an embassy cocktail party and meeting a man named General Gustavo Alvarez. He was not a nice man. He had blood on his hands. But he thought he was very clever. And over his cocktail, he told me, "We have no problem controlling Honduras. Honduras is the poorest country in the region, but the Hondurans don't know they're poor." That was the level of cynicism that that government expressed. And not long after that, I went to the Jesuit Center in El Progreso. They called it a feeding center. And they gathered the malnourished children from the region to look after them as they died. And I saw children who were a year, 2 years old, who weighed a little bit more than a baby and had arms like little sticks. That's when I knew that the Hondurans knew they were poor. We can learn. We Americans can do better. We don't have to live in a world where what we offer to the world are weapons and flawed concepts. We have the ability to reach out to partners in other parts of the world, partners like Berta and Miriam, who can share their wisdom with us, and we can move mountains if we learn to listen. Thank you.
Thank you very much for those very powerful words, words that remind us that the patterns we see, the problems we see, don't just exist in one place. They cross all sorts of boundaries, including the boundaries of time. They keep reappearing over and over. So tonight, we're going to hear about some very powerful examples and very desperate situations, but don't think that they can't reawaken in other places but that we think are safe right now. So Anne, thank you for that reminder. I have the pleasure tonight of welcoming you as chair of the Rothko Chapel. I also am going to have the distinct pleasure of awarding
our medals of honor to our awardees this evening. First, I'm going to tell you a little bit about the history of the chapel and this award. From its founding in 1971, the Rothko Chapel has served as a forum for global human rights. We host and honor the voices of conscience, those who make certain that voices of the less fortunate, the forgotten, and the oppressed are heard. The biannual Óscar Romero Award is a signature piece of our human rights work. Since 1986, the Rothko Chapel has given the award to unsung heroes who are working under extraordinary circumstances to advance human rights. The award centers on the conviction that securing basic dignity and freedom for people worldwide, requires that individuals and organizations challenge abuse beginning from the grassroots. The award includes a $20,000 unrestricted cash stipend given to the individual and or organization to further their work for peace and justice. This award is the 13th that we have given, and is particularly poignant because of the recent beatification of Archbishop Óscar Romero. Recent awardees include Blanca Velázquez of Mexico, Nasera Dutour of Algeria, and Dr. Namagabe Muhibazi of the Democratic Republic of Congo. This year, the board and selection committee voted to share the award between two Hondurans, Berta Cáceres and Miriam Miranda. These awardees have particular local resonance, as Houston has historically been a destination for many Honduran refugees and immigrants. Many people in this community and beyond have worked diligently to support the struggle for true democracy in Honduras and throughout Central America. And with this as the background, it gives me great pleasure to introduce our 2015 Óscar Romero awardees. Berta Cáceres is a Lenca indigenous woman, a founding director and general coordinator of the Consejo Civil de Organizaciones Populares de Indígenas de Honduras, or COPINH for short. She has defended the rights of the campesino and indigenous Lenca descending communities of Western Honduras for more than two decades. COPINH organizes nonviolent demonstrations with community members to protest illegal development projects. And under Berta's leadership, the organization has stopped 15 hydroelectric dam projects, as well as numerous mining operations that would have been built without community consent. These accomplishments have not come without high cost for COPINH and its staff. Eight members of COPINH have died due to their work. Staff, and particularly Berta, have received numerous death threats, and the organization's offices and property are regularly sabotaged and vandalized. Additionally, Berta and COPINH members were detained by the Honduran army and taken before a judge on trumped-up weapon charges, which were subsequently dropped and dismissed, and later on faced new charges for trespassing. Fortunately, all charges against Berta and members of COPINH have been dismissed. Nevertheless, the context in which COPINH works remains extremely tense and dangerous. Berta, the members of your community, but also those with concern for all the citizens of the globe, are grateful for your inspirational leadership. We're also here to honor Miriam Miranda, a Garifuna woman who is executive director of the Organización Fraternal Negra Hondureña, or OFRANA. The group protects on the land, civil, and cultural rights of 47 indigenous Garifuna communities. In defending this land and the resource rights of these people, OFRANA has become a leading advocate against the current mining law, planned model cities, African palm cultivation, and corporate-led development projects that threaten the Garifuna territories. Recently, Ofrana has had a hearing before the Inter-American Human Rights Court in a case that details the failure of the Honduran state to protect the ancestral Garifuna territory from the occupation and dispossession by corporations and private landowners. Miriam's security situation is serious, as Ofrana's work has led her to encounter powerful non-state actors who have threatened her and her family. On the morning of July 17, 2014, several members of the Garifuna people, including Miriam, were temporarily abducted by four heavily armed men while they were visiting a remote area. During a previous visit to the area, community members had discovered that an illegal runway used by drug traffickers and that had been destroyed by the Honduran army in January 2014 was being rebuilt. And these are just examples of Ofrana's courageous work. And Miriam, we are moved by and tremendously grateful for your undaunted leadership. I'm happy to also report that tonight's honorees share a strong solidarity and friendship. When Berta was threatened and criminalized, Miriam's organization responded through an emergency grant. When Miriam was kidnapped, Berta was the first to denounce the act. Together, the two of you make clear that the struggle for justice is not accomplished alone, but must be placed in the context of community. We are inspired by your leadership and undaunted dedication to justice. And it is my honor to present both of you with the 2015 Rothko Chapel Óscar Romero Award. This year's medals were based on the original Óscar Romero logo chosen by Dominic Demeneil and feature an olive tree with the words in Spanish and English, Óscar Romero Award, presented by the Rothko Chapel to Miriam Miranda and Berta Cáceres in recognition of your enormous courage, a voice not silenced. November 12, 2015, Houston, Texas. And with this, I welcome Miriam and Berta up.
Good evening. Good evening, everyone, women and men.
Romero de la Paz, casi imposible en esta tierra en guerra.
Romero of peace, practically impossible in this land of war. Latin America has put you already into the glory of the space. All of the Americas are honoring Óscar Romero. All of the Americas are uniting behind Óscar Romero in all of the trenches, in all of its altars. And with permission from another prophet, in all of the territories, and all of the peoples, and all of the towns, Saint Romero of America, pastor of our people, no one will silence your voice.
Pedro
We can't talk about justice and peace without talking about our co-worker Romero. It doesn't matter what religion we're a member of, even atheists, it doesn't matter. The Lenca people, we're located in the southwest of Honduras. We're a people, a millenary people, who have contributed over the years to the development of justice, to decolonization. We are proud, all of us, men and women of the communities, to do this work for justice and to share also this deep connection with the Salvadoran community. A round of applause for the Salvadoran people, please. The Lenca people were a people of the corn, were a people of the candle, were a people of the rivers, of the earth. And we are also a people, a rebellious people, a people who are continually risen up in the face of humiliation. History has always been written by the dominant people, by the colonizers, and by men. The Lenca people, we have also had a long struggle of delivering martyrs into the struggle. And we have also worked with the historical memory of our people. We are continually rebellious. And within the COPINH, within our organization, since 1973, we've been working, fighting to rescue and to reconstruct our country, to reaffirm our country, and to make our land more ours. We come out of a context, a very difficult context, in a country that is known, as I say often, because we were a military base for the Contras, and we're known also for our coup. But also, we want to say that we have also had social movements and struggles. And just like 500 years ago, the voice of our peoples was lifted up in a context that has continually been difficult because of hegemonic policies, a project based on death and justice and impunity. They've imposed free trade agreements on us. They've imposed a Mesoamerican plan. They've imposed an interconnection plan for electricity. They've imposed an alliance for prosperity that gives millions of dollars to corrupt governments like the one of Juan Orlando Hernández. Also, they've imposed on us the Trans-Pacific Agreement from other regions of the world, which gallop over our peoples. We've had IMF accords imposed on us as well. And we've had all kinds of policies put on us just to further this exploitation. All of these global policies are translated on the local level into a total exploitation of our common goods and our common natural resources. What is imposed is an energy policy as well that attempts to dam 300 rivers in our country, some bigger, some smaller, but all handed over into private hands through illegal and unjust decrees without consultations with the people, not just with indigenous and black communities, but with all communities in Honduras. An energy plan that turns over platforms and turns over natural resources. For example, the BP platform, a rich platform, because we're a rich country. We are not a poor people. We're not a poor people. We're a people that has been impoverished, but we are not a poor people. Also, an energy project that attempts to privatize, that is privatizing in wind projects, that is putting wind power projects into the hands of transnational companies, What's being handed over is our territory, just in the same way it was handed over 500 years ago. Recently, 96 sites were offered over for research to countries of 25 different countries, Saudi Arabia, Canada, of course, Brazil, other countries. Over 800 concessions that were given illegally, that have brought death, in all kinds of different ways. Violations of human rights. Exploitation of mines. As I was saying before about the exploitation of all kinds of our natural resources, like minerals, gold, all kinds of minerals and metals that, of course, the transnational companies are like vultures closing in on our natural resources. It's hard to compare animals with transnational companies, but the other thing that we have is forest resources. And they're imposing this through a green economy, talking about a green economy as a way to get access to natural resources. The green economy is a new form of capitalism. They talk about democracy and about development and even human rights. They say that they're bringing solutions to climate change. But faced with this, our communities have really questioned this, and have really questioned these supposed arguments of transnational politics. Tourist projects that also my compañera Miriam will also talk about. There's a large number of tourist projects that she's facing. GMOs, issues with biological issues, assassinations, killings, criminalization of our struggles and of our processes, in addition to those of us who are fighting for justice. And of course, this whole project, this whole economic project, is also accompanied by a large project of militarization, which has devastated our country. We've been controlled by the military of the United States. There are 6 military bases, U.S. bases, in Honduras. People know about some of the bases, but not about all of them. There are many. And it's not a coincidence. They're all located in indigenous communities. 3 of them are in Mezquito, Garifuna communities. And 3 others are located in Pesebolancho communities, and also where our Creole brothers and sisters live, our Mestizo brothers and sisters in the department of Isla de la Bahia. We're threatened with another military base in Lenca territory. We've talked about it a bit. We also have had U.S. bases in the 80s in Lenca territory. And we know what this means. We know that this is a false pretext of drug trafficking and to fight against terrorism. What they're really trying to do is to exploit our communities. And what we understand is that we're communities of strategic importance for the United States and for the entire hemisphere. Also, we can't fail to mention the fact of criminal attacks on our people, criminal attacks like the coup, another laboratory for all kinds of changes that they're looking to impose in Latin America. Threatening a coup is one strategy. And this attacks the very sovereignty of our people and the very sovereignty of our communities. We'd like to say that faced with this dictatorship of transnational companies, we've decided, women and men, we're in this process of movement, indigenous people, black people, all of us together, that we have the right to dream. It's a subversive dream, subversive right. It's a terrorist right to dream, dreaming, to dream of justice and dignity, to dream of a world where all of us, men and women, have self-determination, where we can decide, what do we want for our country? What model of democracy do we want to use? And indigenous people, indigenous communities, all of us are raising our voice and our own proposals for life, because they always say that we don't have anything. But what is the alternative? We've always had an alternative, our cosmovision, our way of looking at the world, our ways of organizing. This is all part of how the Honduran people can move forward. We've been a process of fighting for our territorial rights, fighting against transnational companies. We have very important struggles like the struggle of Rio Blanco, the struggle in the border, de Lumpa, the struggle in the border with La Paz, fighting for land in Santa Barbara, fights that are led by women. And this, I want to say this, that there cannot be emancipatory struggles if women are not involved. And we believe that the debate and the contribution, all of this must be led by women, and women have to be members of this struggle. And this is what our ancestors have said for more than 500 years. We have to bring the energy of women. And we have to understand this too, because all of us, we're not just here talking about issues of health, but we're also talking about issues of defense of territory, defense of water, defense of our natural resources. We don't want to be decoration. We're fighting for sovereignty, not just the sovereignty of the country, but our own thinking, our own proposals. And there we are walking forward, fighting for this proposal that we're fighting for. Refoundation is what we call it. And we've been weaving together, building alliances with Ofrade, with other organizations, building a social movement in very difficult situations, very complicated situations. And this is a struggle that is built on the word of our peoples, that this is the moment when life emerges. And this isn't just limited to indigenous groups. Of course, we have a right to have an opinion on all matters, not just on indigenous matters. There are people that say that the Lenca people or the Garifuna people don't exist, and we oppose that. We believe strongly that this right to dream, we're going to continue to make that right real. We're going to continue to dream about another kind of Honduras. And we're going to continue to dream of a Honduras that's not a laboratory. We're also fighting this prize is very important. The fact that this prize has the name of Oscar Romero is incredibly important. He's with us. He's accompanying us. He's walking with us in our struggle. Years ago, our people decided to canonize him and made him a saint. It wasn't this year. We made him a saint a long time ago. This prize means a contribution to that process of struggle. Indigenous, black, women's struggles for life. However you want to call it. The right to live well. The right to live with the earth. This prize contributes to that struggle, to that resistance. It also contributes to, on an international level, because Honduras has been put into a very difficult situation, into a situation of crisis. And as I said earlier about the importance of indigenous rights, And she, this person that went and got to know the indigenous rights, this person got to know all of the struggles that we're facing and all of the challenges that we're facing. And this is very important because it means that the Honduran government knows that they're being watched, and they know that we have allies that have a lot of strength and a lot of power, and that solidarity doesn't have borders, and that anti-terrorist laws, anti-criminal laws will not work against international solidarity. They're not going to be able to work against international solidarity. They can't put an end to that. And we think that these connections are incredibly important. It's not a personal recognition, it's not a personal prize, it's a prize for the people. Because we realize that we're not in the struggle alone. We have to continue feeding hope, we have to continue feeding life. Life, as I always say, this humanity and this planet, we have to continue to take care of this planet because we don't have any other planet. Thank you.
I'm a little taller than Berta. Garifuna. We're speaking Garifuna. They're speaking Garifuna, they're not speaking Spanish.
They're
speaking Garifuna, they're not speaking Spanish. That's why I'm not interpreting.
Buenas noches.
Good evening. I allow myself to imitate my beings, my ancestral beings, to come with us in this moment, with everyone here. This is a chapel that's very special. It's a chapel that has no religion. It's a chapel that is open for all the feelings, for all the spiritualities. That's why I invited them to be with us today. It's very important. And for me, it's very important that precisely this recognition is being done here in this chapel. Thank you for that. I am Garifuna, indigenous, Afro-indigenous. Today, every day, with a very strong tendency and a change that wants to happen from the state, that we're Afro-descendants, when all humanity is Afro-descendant. And that's a policy to make us invisible, to deny diversity. And that's what the Honduras government is doing. And it's a campaign, and it's a policy that responds to deny rights. And against that, we have to struggle too. We have to fight as well. So they recognize the diversity and the identity and the culture and the right that we have to be different and to be respected. We are in the coast, in the Atlantic coast of Honduras. And we come from the sea. With Berta, we share not only the fact that we're both women, but also that we share spaces geographically that could be a little different, but there's a lot of things that are similar in solving the problems that we face as indigenous people, and specifically as Afro-indigenous, like Garifunas are.
El reconocimiento a la lucha.
The recognizing of the struggle.
A la resistencia.
Of, to a resistance, la lucha to struggle of our communities.
Por parte de la Capilla Rothko y por parte
on
de
the,
miembros,
from the Rothko Chapel is a recognition
esa lucha fuerte de las mujeres.
That is also recognizing women.
Nosotras decimos que las mujeres no solamente
we
somos
say
de vida,
that we're not only
no
giving
parimos,
birth, not only we give life through birth,
también generamos vida.
We also generate life.
La mayoría
today,
de la resistencia y la lucha
most
por los
of the struggle
por los derechos humanos,
for defending human rights,
por los recursos naturales, por
for
bienes
human
comunes,
resources,
por los
trabajos, for common goods, like we were saying, it's being led by women. A lot of that resistance that is being made invisible, a lot of that struggle by women is not only defending land, but also the air, the forest, the water, and just a little stream of water against mining, for example. It's impressing the levels that we have reached today because of the accelerated loss of common goods and natural resources. I want to share with y'all why we think that it's important to fight for life. This award, we believe that if it's true that it brings attention to Garifuna women and the Lenca people, it's also looking at just defending land and human rights that we're doing across the planet. This is a recognition that is given in a very special context. We are a month away, a little less than a month away, that there's a summit in France for the climate. And we hope that the results are different, but we know what the results are going to be. We believe that it's important and it's necessary to fight so there's responsible decisions for the planet. Those small things that we do in our communities is because we are putting our little sand for a global issue. The planet is collapsing. We are seeing a crisis that is taking us to the destruction of the planet. When we fight for the water in our communities, when we fight for the forest, when we're defending that system and that life or way of life, because we respect the land that gives us life, we are putting our attention locally in something that is global, that is fighting for the future generations. We have a big responsibility. It's not Berta's and Miriam's responsibility. It's a responsibility of all of us. That to think about what are we going to leave for the next generations. Are we going to leave a planet that is desolated, without water, without forest, with air that is breathable, to the future generations of 100, 200 years whenever we're not here? Or are we going to actually contribute to call attention to decision makers? I think that's where we have to pay attention. And that's why we have to question this model of quote-unquote development. Development that is a predator of natural resources, that is not respectful of what gives us life, and also dehumanizing process. We need to talk about love. We need to practice love as well. Now, to save the planet, we can't just talk about solidarity and love. We also have to practice it. And that requires definitely a change of conduct, of behavior, in an individual level and in a collective level. That's what we're doing there. Back home, it's precisely that, fighting for life, like the most precious thing that has been given to us. We can't keep thinking in ourselves only and exclusively. We have to guarantee that the next generations have what we are enjoying now. And that's why we have to act with responsibility, all of us. That's what we do. When we talk
de esta lucha
of this struggle
a cabo en las
that we are carrying in our communities, when we talk
Ofra,
about the fight, we
lo que pasa, por ejemplo,
feel profoundly what is happening in the humanitarian crisis that have been happening in the last few years. We see mothers coming with children exponentially, even for the United States border. We live in a country, like Berta says, that we have a lot of crisis, crisis in all the levels. But we feel that we have the right to build a country where everyone's living well there. That's the challenge. That's the true challenge. We're always going to keep having people that are migrating to the United States and to other North countries if there's not the conditions for us to be able to stay. And that's why we're asking if those 1,000 million are actually going to resolve the problems, or are they going to just finance the politicians or finance the massive production of gas and combustibles in Latin America after Colombia? Honduras is one of the biggest countries doing this. We're not cultivating. We're not cultivating as much as we were doing in the 1970s. And you know what's the answer of the World Bank whenever we claim this? No one comes out of the country. No one gets out of poverty if they're just eating beans and cultivating beans. And you said, no, you're wrong, because with that policy, all the people in Honduras are going to come to the United States. The production of palm is not only destroying the earth, but it's also making us have to migrate. So we have to make responsible decisions. It's necessary. It's necessary to call decision makers. About the responsibility, the historical responsibility that we have today.
Como
like, as an organization,
no
we don't do wonders.
Estamos
we are
de la
sure that there's the need to express, to connect, to hug each other, to give us love in the struggle. We thank deeply the possibility to come here to Houston.
Houston
is one of the cities that has a really big Garifuna population and Central Americans in general. And Mexicans, well, they're just retaking the space that is theirs. We just came like walking, but we're retaking it. And that's wonderful, because we also do it. We just repopulate the land that was already ours. And this is a way, a very clear way, that our people are coming back to their roots. We are convinced of the need to fortify the cultural identity in the struggle of human rights. The Garifuna people are an Afro-Indigenous people, and we have been struggling not just to be seen as like people that dance. Everyone's like, oh, do you dance punta? Because that's what sells, right? Garifunas, people dance punta. But we also do other things. And we don't only dance punta. We believe that the people, that indigenous peoples, the culturally different people, we are fighting to save the planet because the last resources that are left in this planet are in our territories, our land. That's why whenever we're fighting for our forests or land, we're not only fighting for ourselves, we are fighting for the planet. And that's a very important thing. And in that sense, we give a lot of value to this recognition of the resistance of the Garifuna peoples, because we're not just fighting for our land. When we oppose to those projects of developing death, we are fighting for the planet, because we understand that we need a planet that is healthy so human beings can live healthy as well. We thank deeply, my friends, this recognition, this award, especially because it recognizes also all the women, all the Garifuna women, also men, but a bunch of Garifuna women, my friends, that hug each other to save our land. They're there. They're fighting, defending. They're being persecuted. Many women that are right now and tomorrow in a very historical struggle in a community against a Canadian that has taken over all of the coast to supposedly cultivate development. The day that we question development for what? Of who? What kind of development do we want? The day is today. If we want to save this planet, we have to question that. We need to humanize the planet. We need to hug each other. We need to understand that we can't follow or chase this suicidal run. Thank you very much. Long live to Honduran women.
Miriam, thank you for your words of power and passion. I think we were all tremendously moved by what you had to tell us, and it reminded me of Dominique de Menil's own words, that the Rothko Chapel is a place for contemplation and action. And I think tonight we felt the power of her statement embodied in these two women. And I hope it has inspired all of us to carry out the action piece that is so much a part of what we do here. I want to thank you all so much for coming. I want you to please join us. Our celebration continues out on the plaza. We will have delicious Central American food and Garifuna music from Walangante, which is a Garifuna band. I want to give special thanks to the Houston Arts Alliance, Folklife and Traditional Arts Program for their assistance and for all the people who made tonight such an inspiring evening. Thank you all for coming.